Live from WRAL News Headquarters in Raleigh, your number one source for local news. WRAL News, coverage you can count on.
We're dry right now, but we are likely to have a few isolated showers between now and lunchtime, and then a round of thunderstorms late this afternoon and evening. I'll show you the timeline.
Begins today, challenging the state's voter ID laws. Just ahead, I'll explain the arguments in this case and how it could impact the 2024 general election.
Good morning and happy Monday to you. Thanks for joining us. I'm Michelle McConaughey.
And I'm Chris Lovingood. The Sunday scaries are gone. We're into Monday now, but we want to welcome you into the morning by first getting you started on your day and your commute. The best way to do that is with your forecast with meteorologist Elizabeth Gardner.
You know, it was a wet weekend. You know, some parts of the viewing area saw more rain Saturday, others on Sunday. We're going to continue that trend all the way into Friday. Right now, it's nice and dry, but again, this afternoon and evening, we're going to see a better chance for showers and thunderstorms. One thing that's going to change that'll be different from the weekend is that we're going to have maybe a few more breaks in the clouds, a lot more heat and humidity. It's going to feel like summertime for sure. We take a look at futurecast here at noon, right after lunchtime, mid to late afternoon. We get into this band of scattered thunderstorms. Rain will be heavy at times. It'll be blustery, but it may not reach severe criteria today. We have a better chance of seeing severe criteria winds for tomorrow and again on Wednesday. You can see those lines of thunderstorms kind of coming through here all the way through around 10 or 11 o'clock. This is a look at our chance for rain today. Again, you can see how it goes up during the afternoon and into the evening. Right now, we take a live look at Wilson. It is dry. It's a little breezy out there. We have a southwest wind right now at 8 miles per hour and a temperature of 70 in the triangle. We'll see temperatures climbing into the mid 80s for this afternoon. We will be very warm and sticky all week, so we have that severe threat that will increase starting tomorrow. We have a severe threat Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. I'll walk you through it coming up, Ken.
All right, 802, Elizabeth. We're seeing the usual morning congestion building on the north side of the Beltline and the south side. This is a live look from the Beltline and Capitol Boulevard. You can see the traffic in the westbound lanes heading away from us there. This is what it looks like on the sensors this morning. You can see that traffic is backed up all the way from the split all the way back to that whole section of that northern section of the Beltline. Give yourself some extra time this morning if you have to navigate that area. We're also seeing some bumper-to-bumper traffic on I-540 in the westbound lanes as well, coming in from this area of town. Just make sure you're giving yourself some extra time as well if you have to navigate that area as well. Elsewhere in the triangle, all the major routes in the capital city, 87 coming in from Knightdale, not a problem to report, but definitely when you come in from 87, you're going to run into that northern section of the Beltline right there with that bumper-to-bumper traffic. Give yourself some extra time this morning if you have to navigate that area.
New this morning, hundreds of UNC faculty and staff are calling for student protesters to be allowed back in school after facing suspension. This is happening after last week's police action toward pro-Palestinian protesters on campus. As WREL's Kelsey Coffey explains, those school employees want administrators to walk back some disciplinary action they've taken.
More than 500 employees signed a petition, and barricades are still surrounding the quad today, nearly a week after police and protesters clashed here on campus. This is a look now at when officers cleared an encampment on the quad last Tuesday. 36 protesters were detained. 13 of them were students, some facing charges like assaulting a government official and resisting arrest. These faculty members are calling on UNC's administration. They're asking them to allow student protesters who were detained and suspended back in school. The faculty members plan to deliver this petition to school leaders later this afternoon at the Peace and Justice Plaza here on campus. We'll be sure to have a crew here and keep you updated. Kelsey Coffey, WRAL News in Chapel Hill.
And this morning, police are still looking for a person who shot someone while they were driving in Zebulon. The shooting happened within walking distance of Five County Stadium. That's where the Carolina Mudcats play. Police say the driver was shot Sunday evening, causing them to crash. WRAL crews on scene saw a sedan with broken glass and a smashed hood off on the side of the road. Police say the driver was taken to the hospital. No word on their condition.
Today, a Smithfield man is expected in court. He's accused of causing a bus crash in Johnston County that injured several students. 30-year-old Trevor Grice faces felony hit and run, among other charges. Authorities say he hit that bus with his car on Friday. Surveillance camera video shows the moment that crash happened. Let's play that for you on your screen. You can see the bus pushed off the road and ended up in someone's front yard right there. 13 children were on board when this happened, and 8 of them had to be taken to the hospital. Troopers say that Grice was driving with a revoked license at the time.
today, the argument over whether you should need to bring a photo ID to your polling place is going in front of a judge. This trial could play a role in the election coming up in November. As WREL's Laura Levine explains, the NAACP argues the photo ID requirement is discriminatory.
This long-awaited trial begins later this morning. Voting activists and the NAACP argued that the law was enacted with discriminatory intent and has already had an impact on minorities. Voter ID has been in effect since last April following a long string of court cases. The March primary was the first major test of the law in recent years. Republican state legislative leaders who intervened as defendants in the case plan to point out that the law offers broad exceptions to voters who do not have an ID and that the March primary ran smoothly.
People bringing the case will say it's not just the fact that, you know, 99.9% of North Carolinians were able to vote using their ID, but it was people who chose not to go to the polls at all because they were concerned about the voter ID.
The case has the potential to block the state's voter ID requirement before the November election. However, an appeal is likely. The trial begins at 9:30 this morning at the Winston-Salem Federal Courthouse. It is expected to last 10 days. Laura Levine, WREL News in Raleigh.
Today, we'll get an idea of how Wake County leaders want to spend your tax dollars. Wake County Manager David Ellis will present his recommended budget for the 2025 fiscal year during tonight's regular board meeting. Last year, the Board of Commissioners approved a near $2 billion budget. That included investments in education, public safety, and affordable housing, too. Tonight's meeting is expected to start at 5 o'clock.
This week, members of House Speaker Mike Johnson's own party are looking to oust him from power. Republican Congresswoman Marjorie Taylor Greene says she plans to introduce a resolution calling for Johnston's ouster. She is unhappy that he pushed through a foreign aid package that helps Ukraine, Israel, and Taiwan. She says that Johnson has compromised too much with Democrats. It's unclear how many Republican members will side with her. Many Republicans oppose this push because they don't want the party to fight like it did when Speaker Kevin McCarthy was ousted last year.
This morning, local leaders and lawmakers are calling for a better post office in Holly Springs. Congressman Wiley Nickel will call on USPS officials to fix issues that neighbors there have been facing. He says there are long lines and wait times because the facility was built before the population really took off. A press conference about this is set for 9 a.m. That's not too long from now. Within the next hour, that's going to happen at the Holly Springs post office.
Well, this week, your input is wanted in the search for a new Durham Public School superintendent. There will be three meetings for the community to weigh in on what they want in a new superintendent. The first is tonight at the former Northern High School on Tom Wilkerson Road. You can also attend a meeting tomorrow at Hillside High or Wednesday at Southern School of Energy and Sustainability. All of the meetings begin at 6 p.m.
Members of the North Carolina Emergency Management Swift Water Rescue Team are headed to Texas. Southeast Texas is seeing devastating flooding right there on your screen. It intensified by another round of storms. Texas game wardens have joined emergency services in rescue efforts. At least 224 people have been saved from flooding. A five-year-old boy unfortunately died after the car he and two adults were in got stuck in the swift water. Both adults were rescued.
The Carolina Hurricanes will be looking to rebound in game two of their series with the New York Rangers tomorrow night. The Canes find themselves in an early hole in the series after a 4-3 loss in game one yesterday afternoon. The Canes scored a goal with less than 2 minutes left to get within one, but they were unable to get the tying goal before time ran out. Game two will be 7 o'clock tomorrow night in New York.
Intense rescues from flooding in Brazil. The effort that's happening there to save people right now as thousands are trying to escape the rising water.
And you may feel overwhelmed sometimes at work, right? What mental health experts say you and your managers can do to help you improve your quality of life.
And we're looking at another round of scattered showers and thunderstorms mid to late afternoon. It'll also be a warm day with temperatures in the 80s. I'll show you a summer-like pattern headed our way this week coming up.
Getting you a live look right now outside at Goldsboro. I know, not the sunshine we really would like on a nice Monday. We got a little cloud coverage there and Well, bad news is going to be sticking around for most of the day here today. We've got meteorologist Elizabeth Gardner, who's been tracking a little bit more on that, not just for today, but also the rest of the week for your forecast.
It's going to be quite a week. Lots of things to watch for. Afternoon and evening storms, some of which could be severe. It's going to be hot and humid on several of those days. But the weekend looks like it'll feel like spring again. I'll show you coming up. Right now, dual Doppler 5000 radar. A couple of showers up near Mecklenburg County, Virginia. It's been dry for a bit. We had some early showers this morning. Here's a look at the rain the last 24 hours. We've got a good soaking in a lot of places in the last 24 hours, anywhere from half an inch to about an inch and a half. And you can see the brighter colors, the pinks and the reds. That's where we had those rainfall amounts over an inch and a half to 2 inches. So it was good to get that soaking. We have more rain on the way this week, that's for sure. Goldsboro, nice and cloudy. Apex is as well. Chapel Hill, courtesy of Top of the Hill Restaurant. And of course, our newsroom there in Fayetteville. We may see a sprinkle or two between now and lunchtime, but the best chance for rain comes mid to late afternoon, 3 or 4 o'clock. We start to see this line of storms coming through. Rain will be heavy at times. It'll be blustery, but we probably won't reach severe criteria. Winds would be 58 miles per hour or stronger, but we'll have several waves. You can see more of this coming through during the evening. We'll likely wake up to a few isolated showers tomorrow morning. We might see a little sunshine tomorrow afternoon. Now, that may sound great, but our highs will be in the upper 80s, and it will be humid, so not very comfortable outside tomorrow afternoon. And then we'll wrap up the day during the evening with that potential for stronger thunderstorms. Now, we do have a level 2 risk for tomorrow. Damaging winds, heavy rain possible. And then Wednesday, also same story. Thursday looks like potentially an even better chance for severe storms. Some of that could linger into Friday. So it is going to be a bit of a stormy week, especially during the afternoons. How much rainfall total? Most likely all total through the week will easily end up with an inch. Look at that. This is a brand new run of the computer models, 2 to 3 inches. That's certainly not out of the question, especially if those storms set up in the same place day after day. Looking ahead to the weekend, Mother's Day looking much nicer. Mid 70s on Saturday and Sunday, comfortable temperatures. The humidity backs off, but we may see a few isolated thunderstorms on Sunday. And if you like those cooler temperatures, you don't want it to be summer yet, we got some good news. The 14th through the 20th, at least we have the potential for below normal temperatures. I'll keep my fingers crossed for that, that's for sure. We're going to hit 90 Wednesday and upper 80s for Tuesday and Thursday, but Friday our temperatures cool off. Saturday looks like an amazing day, and really Mother's Day not bad either, Ken.
Oh, that's good to hear. At 8:15, Elizabeth checking the traffic conditions. We continue to monitor this traffic buildup that's been happening for the last hour or so. This is usually part of the morning commute that we see there in the north side of the Beltline, coming off of 87 South, coming into the Beltline. You can see that bumper-to-bumper traffic. Just give yourself some extra time. I would recommend taking the south side of the Beltline, but that's picking up as well. There's a live camera now at I-440 and Capitol Boulevard. You see, traffic is picking up, but it's moving relatively smoothly this morning. But again, give yourself that extra time. Elsewhere in the Triangle, we're seeing on 540, we used to have a big delay up on the 540 right there. It's not pretty much dissipated right now. In Durham, we're seeing this in both directions on 885 and the Durham Freeway. We've been seeing some bumper-to-bumper traffic, some slowdowns there, but nothing really that's going to make you late for work this morning. But we'll keep checking these traffic conditions in the WRL Traffic Center.
Jeff Hogan in the WRL Live Center. This is Kendra Cromer, a 12-year-old who lives outside Washington, D.C., and he has become the first person in the world to begin a commercially approved gene therapy that is designed to cure sickle cell disease. Now, this is him having his bone marrow stem cells removed for gene editing, faces months of treatment. Sickle cell is a very painful blood disorder of the red blood cells, but Kendrick says he is a pioneer and he wants to be cured of all this and possibly bring some hope to the 100,000 people in the country who have sickle cell disease, mostly black. 20,000 of them would qualify for this treatment, but it is very, very expensive in the millions of dollars.
Wow. All right. Thanks, Jeff. Pro-Palestinian protests continue at college campuses around the country. Officers cleared out a protest encampment at the University of Southern California yesterday morning. No arrests were made. Saturday, we saw protesters interrupt the University of Michigan's commencement and more than 24 protesters arrested at the University of Virginia when police broke up an encampment there.
What was supposed to be a day of celebration turned tragic at Ohio State University. Someone died during the graduation ceremony yesterday. A spokesperson for the university said that person fell from the stands and then died. That happened just 30 minutes after the ceremony began. and the commencement continued uninterrupted, and students leaving the ceremony walked past the investigation site as they were leaving.
One person in Houston is dead after dangerous floodwaters raged through Texas this weekend. Since Friday, hundreds of people have been rescued across that state. Some areas got more than 2 feet of water over a few days. 8 million people are still under flood alerts in Texas, Oklahoma, and Arkansas. Some people are returning to their homes to find almost everything destroyed.
New footage is showing the massive flooding in Brazil's southernmost state. Look at this video here on your screen. You can see the water up to this man's neck as he tries to guide his family out of a building. He was carrying a young girl on his shoulders, you saw there. More than 88,000 people were forced to evacuate their homes, and many people were using jet skis and boats to escape the flooding. Brazilian leaders say 75 people are dead and 103 people are still missing.
Surfers in Mexico are protesting after two Australians and an American were killed. Family members identified the three people as Australian brothers Callum and Jake Robinson and American Jack Rode. Mexican authorities say the men were likely killed during a robbery attempt for their truck tires in the Baja Peninsula. The men's bodies were then dumped in a remote well. Investigators found a fourth unidentified body that had been in the well longer. Three suspects are being held in connection with the murders.
The Canes dropped game one of their series in New York yesterday, but that's not stopping Canes Nation back here from cheering them on. There were a lot of people decked out in Canes gear at Tietz in Glenwood South. And despite the disappointing loss, fans say there is still a lot of time to get back into this series.
To see everybody else repping fuels you. You gotta live for it. You gotta wear that passion. Wear the red.
It was actually like an absolute nail-biter of a game towards the end of it, man. It was crazy. It was crazy.
It's game one on the road. I expect game three and four to go to the Canes one.
That last guy clearly not worried there. The Canes will host games three and four of the series at PNC Arena on Thursday and Saturday.
May is Mental Health Awareness Month, and while many of us spend hours at our jobs, some psychology experts want to make sure that the time spent working isn't having a negative effect on our health. Chris DeMeo takes a closer look at what companies can do to promote better workplace mental health.
No matter what you do for work or how good you are at your job, it's normal for everyone to get overwhelmed from time to time while on the clock.
Everyone has their breaking point.
But with May marking National Mental Health Awareness Month, psychologists say prioritizing your well-being at your workplace could improve your quality of life in and outside the office.
In terms of the factors that influence the mental health of employees, I think the biggest factor is stressors in their work environment. So especially stressors that employees have no control over.
While some people are prone to handling stress better than others,
there's the personality trait of hardiness. And people who are high in hardiness, they feel like they have control over their environment.
Thomas Britt of Clemson University says managers can take active roles in helping their employees develop strategies to keep them from buckling under the pressure.
You can teach individuals and employees to try to take more control over their environment where they're able to. You can help them see the meaning in what they're doing. And you can train them to get experience handling multiple tasks at once.
When it comes to younger employees in Gen Z, psychology experts say it's important for many to feel like what they're doing at work is making a difference. Britt thinks companies that help their workers feel seen and heard can positively influence workplace mental health, and this can help businesses in the long run.
The organizations that show this high level of supportive climate are going to be the ones that attract the highest quality recruits.
And that was Chris DeMeo reporting.
Runners from across the globe united under one organization for charity. More than 250,000 people took part in the Wings for Life World Run on Sunday. The organization raises money to fund research projects and clinical studies in the U.S. to heal spinal cord injuries. The run featured 345 starting points worldwide, and runners averaged about 7.1 miles. More than $8.7 million was raised for this event.
Sam's Club says AI could speed up your shopping trip. Sam's Club says all its locations will add AI to its exits by the end of this year. It'll be used to verify receipts for people who are waiting to leave the store. Sam's Club says this technology is already in use at about 20% of its stores.
A Wall Street Journal report says Americans have hit their price limits when it comes to big brand names, specifically in fast food restaurants and grocery stores. Fast food restaurants have reported a drop in orders. Meanwhile, grocery stores say that many people are turning to generic brands of food items instead of the big name brands. The report adds that the customer pullback is forcing companies to use deals and promotions, even if it costs them more.
Tonight, Boeing plans to send its first astronaut crew to space after years of delays. The Starliner is expected to launch tonight, carrying two NASA astronauts to the International Space Station. And the mission is set to take off from Cape Canaveral at 10:34 tonight. It has cost Boeing more than $1 billion during its production, which started back in 2014.
A lot of people will be watching that carefully there. Hundreds of faculty and staff at UNC are calling for students who were suspended after last week's protests to return to campus. In just a bit, you are going to hear what the staff is planning to demand amnesty for those students.
Plus, the search continues for the person responsible for shooting a driver in Zebulon. We'll have those stories coming up on Fox 50.
As you get into your car, tune to WRAL News Plus on your radio in Raleigh on 99.3 FM, in Durham 96.5 FM, and everywhere on 101.5 HD3.
Good morning. Happy Monday. Time now is 8:26. I'm Michelle McConaughey. We are dry for now, but that could change later on. Meteorologist Elizabeth Gardner has a live look at what the conditions are right now.
So we're looking at dry conditions, as you said, Michelle. We did have a couple of isolated showers earlier this morning in our northern counties. Some of that is trying to redevelop back to our west right now. So we have a small chance of some isolated showers this morning, but mid to late afternoon, we have a better chance of scattered showers and thunderstorms across our area. In Apex right now, it is dry but cloudy. We're not likely to see any sunshine today. Temperatures heading out right now are upper 60s, Lewisburg, Southern Pines sitting at 70, 71 in Fayetteville and in Goldsboro. If you're exercising, you want to do it as early as you can. We get into the middle of the afternoon. It's going to be hot and pretty muggy too with mid 80s. And then during the evening, you may be having to deal with some scattered thunderstorms. Ken?
Elizabeth, we're seeing the usual morning congestion building on the Beltline, particularly in the northern section coming in from I-87 out to the Beltline there. Also, we're seeing it in Raleigh's south side as well near Lake Wheeler Road. If you have to navigate this area, definitely give yourself some extra time. Right now, just to get from the Beltline to US 1, it's a 6-minute delay. A couple of minutes ago, that was a 10-minute delay. So things are getting better out there. So just be careful as you head out this morning.
All right. Thanks, Ken. More than 500 UNC faculty and staff members are calling for student protesters to be allowed back in school after facing suspension. It comes after last week's police action toward pro-Palestinian protesters on campus. 13 students were detained. The faculty members plan to deliver the letter later this afternoon. And coming up next on Fox 50, Congressman Wiley Nickel is calling on USPS officials to fix the Holly Springs post office. And next on Today, pediatric cancer patients reunite with nurses who cared for them.
Shot in 4K ultra high definition, your number one source for local news. WRAL News, coverage you can count on.
Right now, we're looking at dry conditions and dual Doppler 5000 radar, but later this afternoon, scattered showers and thunderstorms will develop. I'll show you the timeline.
Today, the argument over whether you should bring your ID to the polls to vote is headed to court. How the voter ID lawsuit could play a major role in the upcoming election.
And the Carolina Hurricanes are hoping to be 1-1 tomorrow after losing to the New York Rangers last night. The changes they're planning to make after a rough start to round two. We'll see what the Canes can do tomorrow. We'll talk about that coming up. Thanks for joining us. I'm Michelle McConaughey.
And I'm Chris Levengood. They're down, but they're not out.
They're
we'll
not
see
out.
How well they perform
game one,
the rest
that's
of this
it.
Week. Yeah, just game one. We've got meteorologist Elizabeth Gardner here to get you started on your week. A little cloud covers to start the day off.
Yeah, it's a gray start out there this morning. And a little bit on the damp side, we take a look at dual Doppler 5000 radar. It's quiet right now. We had a few sprinkles earlier this morning. We could see an isolated shower closer to lunchtime. You could see how one or two of those kind of swing through around noon. But mid to late late afternoon is when we'll have a better chance of some scattered thunderstorms. They may not reach severe criteria today, but we'll have a better chance of severe storms in the afternoon and evening, really for the rest of the week, Tuesday through Friday. You can see some of the waves of rain moving through. Some of that may end up being heavy at times with some blustery winds. Our chance of rain goes up as we get to mid to late afternoon to 50%, and then potentially to 60% just there around 8, 9, or 10 o'clock. Taking a live look at Wilson, the breeze is spinning the whirling gigs just lightly with mostly cloudy skies. Southwest wind at 8, 71 is our temperature right now. We'll climb into the mid-80s for highs later on this afternoon. Along with our better chance for scattered storms and some severe weather, it's also going to be a fairly hot and sticky week starting later on. I'll show you when to expect that coming up, Ken.
All new in the WRA Traffic Center, we're just getting reports of a bus crash in Smithfield. It's happening on Stevens Chapel Road right there. WRA's Jeff Hogan is in the WRA Live Center working to get some more information. He'll have more on that for you in just a couple of minutes or so. Elsewhere in the Triangle, we're seeing the usual morning commute and the congestion building up on the north side of the Beltline as well as the south side of the Beltline. This is coming in off of 87 South in that northern section of the Beltline there. It's actually beginning to clear up just a little bit because that used to be fire red a little while ago. On the south side, we're seeing some bumper-to-bumper traffic down around the Lake Wheeler Road exit. To that end, let's give you a live look and show you what the delay times just to get from the Beltline to US 1 this morning is going to cost you an additional 7 minutes. So definitely give yourself some extra time. This is what I wanted to show you. The I-40 and Lake Wheeler Road, this is the morning congestion that we've been talking about. Of course, the westbound lanes are moving away from us. So if you have to navigate that area this morning, if you're heading out in the next few minutes, definitely give yourself some extra time.
And Ken, I do want to give you just a little bit of information from what we know. North Carolina State Highway Patrol is on that scene. They are investigating a bus crash. Happened in Smithfield. I'm just going to push in on this map just a little bit. Now, the major U.S. highway that you see there, 42, it's south of that on Stevens Chapel Road, and it's the road that runs north and south right along here. So we have a crew on the way there as well, just to try to figure out a little bit more information on this bus crash. But that's what State Highway Patrol is reporting to us right now. So we are headed in the vicinity of that area to try to get some more information.
All right, thanks, Jeff. And new this morning, hundreds of faculty and staff at UNC are calling for students who have been suspended to be allowed back in school. They were suspended over their involvement in the pro-Palestinian protests on campus. And as WRL's Kelsey Coffey shares, those school employees will deliver a petition with hundreds of signatures to school leaders today.
More than 500 employees signed a petition and barricades are still surrounding the quad today, nearly a week after police and protesters clashed here on campus. This is a look now at when officers cleared an encampment on the quad last Tuesday. 36 protesters were detained. 13 of them were students, some facing charges like assaulting a government official and resisting arrest. These faculty members are calling on UNC's administration. They're asking them to allow student protesters who were detained and suspended back in school. The faculty members plan to deliver this petition to school leaders later this afternoon at the Peace and Justice Plaza here on campus. We'll be sure to have a crew here and keep you updated. Kelsey Coffey, WRL News. In Chapel Hill.
This morning, police are still looking for a person who shot a driver while they were in motion in Zebulon. The shooting happening within walking distance of Five County Stadium. That's where the Carolina Mudcats play, if you're familiar. Police said the driver was shot Sunday evening, causing them to crash. A WREL crew on scene saw a sedan with broken glass and a smashed hood off to the side of the road. Police say the driver was taken to the hospital, and WREL is working to learn how that person's doing this morning.
Today, a Smithfield man accused of causing a school bus crash in Johnston County that injured several students is due back in court. 30-year-old Trevor Grice faces felony hit and run and other charges after authorities say he hit that bus with his car on Friday. Surveillance camera video shows the moment the dramatic bus crash happened. You can see it right here, crashing right onto somebody's front yard. 13 children were on board that bus. 8 had to be taken to the hospital. Troopers say that Grice was driving with a revoked license at the time.
A court case starting today could decide whether you will need to keep your ID with you when you're voting. As WRL's Laura Levine shares, this could play a role in the November election.
This long-awaited trial begins later this morning. Voting activists and the NAACP argue that the law was enacted with discriminatory intent and has already had an impact on minorities. Voter ID has been in effect since last April following a long string of court cases. The March primary was the first major test of the law in recent years. Republican state legislative leaders who intervened as defendants in the case plan to point out that the law offers broad exceptions to voters who do not have an ID and that the March primary ran smoothly.
People bringing the case will say it's not just the fact that, you know, 99.9% of North Carolinians were able to vote using their ID, but it was people who chose not to go to the polls at all because they were concerned about the voter ID.
The case has the potential to block the state's voter ID requirement before the November election. However, an appeal is likely. The trial begins at 9:30 this morning at the Winston-Salem Federal Courthouse. It is expected to last 10 days. Laura Levine, WRAL News in Raleigh.
Today, we'll get an idea of how Wake County leaders want to spend your tax dollars. Wake County Manager David Ellis will present his recommended budget for the 2025 fiscal year during tonight's regular board meeting. Last night, the Board of Commissioners approved a $1.8 billion budget that included investments in education, public safety, and affordable housing. Tonight's meeting starts at 5 o'clock.
The Carolina Hurricanes will be looking to rebound in game two of their series with the New York Rangers tomorrow night. The Canes find themselves in an early hole in the series after a 4-3 loss in game one yesterday afternoon. The Canes scored a goal with less than 2 minutes left, but they were unable to get the tying goal before time ran out. Game two will start at 7 o'clock tomorrow night in New York. And in less than 10 minutes, we'll check in with WRAL's Casey Hintz. She is at Madison Square Garden with reaction from the players and how they're looking ahead to game two.
Pro-Palestinian protesters make their voices heard in Chapel Hill once again. They marched down Franklin Street on Sunday afternoon in protest of the university's handling of last week's encampment on campus. Hundreds of people gathered Sunday with the crowd growing as the march went on. Protesters then made their way from Franklin Street to the campus quad and stopped at the South Building where they protested UNC's action to bring in police on Tuesday.
Bringing out riot gear against your own students, it's not going to go down in your resume very well. Not only will the students remember this, the entire community remember this, the universities, not only of North Carolina, but the universities of the entire U.S. will remember this.
There was a small group of counter-protesters following along the route as well. They were holding flags of Israel.
It's tough to see so many dejected Jewish students feeling like they have no other outlets to go because the sheer quantities of pro-Palestinian, anti-Israel protesters are just so high and the number of us is just so low.
Chapel Hill police blocked off roads along the march route. They confirmed that no arrests were made.
Concerns about facilities that care for our most vulnerable young people.
Anytime she's been there, it's been involuntary and she really hasn't had the help that she needs.
Mental health facilities for children owned by a single company. WRAL investigates allegations of abuse, over-medication, as well as several escapes. Hear what we found and state inspectors uncovered. That's tonight at 6 o'clock.
Madonna's proving she is still on top. The records the material girl is breaking, including her own, after the last night of her celebration tour.
Plus, fashion's biggest night is here. Why Vogue's Anna Wintour says that she broke one of her cardinal rules with this year's theme.
Back here in the WRAL Live Center, I got some breaking news to tell you about. We are getting some information from the Person County Sheriff's Office. I want to take you back to this video from the WRAL breaking news tracker last night, responding to the scene of where a shooting potentially took place. Now, the Person County Sheriff's Office has confirmed this morning there was a shooting involving a law enforcement officer in Person County. We are trying to get some more information from the Person County Sheriff's Office. The SBI has taken over this investigation. We do expect a news release to come out on this soon. We'll bring that to you when we get it.
843, checking radar to begin with. A couple of showers down here in Charlotte. Some of that is likely to kind of sneak into our southwestern counties here in the next few hours. We can see a few isolated showers popping up between now and lunchtime, and then a better chance for scattered storms mid to late afternoon. We did see some rain over the weekend. The western part of the viewing area saw most of it Saturday, and then it spread eastward on Sunday. This is a look at the last 24 hours, and we had an average of about an inch to an inch and a half or so. It was a good soaking for a lot of folks, definitely. We do have a level one risk for severe storms for tomorrow and again on Wednesday. Tomorrow, our far southern counties are not affected, but the entire viewing area for Wednesday, we're going to see increasing heat and humidity. It's a real summer-like pattern that we're going to end up seeing with that chance for some afternoon and evening thunderstorms. Let's talk about today. You can see that potential for just a few isolated showers earlier, and then by 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon, we have the potential for a band of some heavy rain and some scattered storms to come through. That's likely to continue on through the evening. Notice there again at midnight, we see that. Tomorrow morning, a small chance of a shower, and then during the afternoon and evening, a better chance of scattered thunderstorms, especially as we start to get into some of that daytime heating. So it's just going to be something we're going to see all week long. Each day between now and Friday, we'll have afternoon and evening storms with a chance that some of those could be severe, especially starting tomorrow. The breeze is starting to pick up here in Wilson. Here's a live look. Lots of cloud cover. We have a southwest wind right now at about, it's been about 5 to 10 miles per hour so far this morning. 71 now. We'll see temperatures in the mid-80s this afternoon. 84 in Raleigh, 83 Durham, 88 in Fayetteville. Might see a little peak of sunshine, but we'll likely see a lot of cloud cover for the bulk of the day. Watch how our dew points start to climb into the upper 60s and even into the low 70s. We haven't hit 70 degrees yet for the dew point this year. That is our tropical, our highest sort of feel for the dew point. We'll see that dropping noticeably by the weekend, which will feel much more comfortable. But upper 80s tomorrow, 90 Wednesday, upper 80s Thursday. Hot, humid, maybe a peak of sunshine or two, but a good chance for afternoon and evening storms, some of which could produce some wind damage. Then we'll see that cold front coming through. It drops our temperatures for the weekend, and it drops the humidity as well. Right now, looking pretty good for Mother's Day, just a small chance for a storm.
All right, thanks, Elizabeth. Holocaust Days of Remembrance are being observed across the U.S. this week. Sunday, the North Carolina Museum of Art held a Music of Remembrance event. It featured two instruments from survived Nazi-era Germany, a piano and a violin. They belonged to Jewish sisters who were promising musicians in Munich in the early 1900s. The sisters and their instruments were separated with the rise of the Nazi rule. One of the sisters was killed at the Auschwitz concentration camp. The other survived and had a family. It's her son who brought the instruments together again.
You can kill the body, but you can't kill the spirit. You can't kill the voice. And musical instruments have a voice that can live forever.
The violin and piano were played together by Jacqueline Saud Wilborski and principal violinist at the North Carolina Symphony, and Mimi Solomon, a chamber pianist, and a UNC Chapel Hill School of Music lecturer.
Oh, powerful pieces of history there. A firefighter from the Triangle was honored during a solemn service in Maryland for fallen firefighters across the nation.
Jeremy Clem, Durham Fire Department.
Jeremy Clem of the Durham Fire Department died of COVID-19 complications back in 2022. He was 45 years old at the time. Clem's name is now written on a plaque at the National Fallen Firefighters Memorial. Four other men from North Carolina were also honored at services there this weekend.
Voters will decide the Republican nominee for lieutenant governor next week. That's when Jim O'Neill and Hal Weatherman face off in a primary runoff. The winner will face Democrat Rachel Hunt in November. O'Neill is the Forsyth County District Attorney. Weatherman was chief of staff for former Lieutenant Governor Dan Forrest. The lieutenant governor's seat is open to newcomers because incumbent Mark Robinson is running for governor. O'Neill and Weatherman have different ideas for how to lead the office. For a look at their records and their priorities, check out our in-depth article at the NC Capitol section of WREL.com.
The Carolina Hurricanes will need to bounce back in game two of their series with the New York Rangers. They're down 1-0 in the series after dropping game one. WREL's Casey Hintz is at Madison Square Garden with post-game reaction from the players after that tough loss.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Casey Hintz inside Madison Square Garden, where last night the Hurricanes fell 4-3 to the Rangers in game one of the second round of the Stanley Cup playoffs. Carolina spotted New York one early and then allowed two power play goals in the first period, and that was the difference here last night.
Our kill is obviously predicated on pressure, and they got to make three or four good passes to get a grade A, and they did, and it was pretty evident. They made some good plays. We'll adjust. We'll find ways to pressure maybe more at the right times and right opportunities and make sure we can do a better job.
We did a lot of good things in that game, especially at the end. We got good pressure on them and obviously got one goal back and the second one wasn't too far either. So, got to build on that.
I mean, it's one game. They did a nice job. They executed two real nice plays. I thought we did a pretty good job on our power play. There was just, it didn't go in tonight. So that's why you play seven games.
Now, D'Angelo went on to say, hey, it's just one game. And that's exactly why you play a seven-game series. Now, the fellas are going to get right back to work later today, actually at the Prudential Center in Newark. I'll be heading over there as we get ready for game two here tomorrow night. Casey Hintz, WREL Sports, Manhattan.
And the season is over for the defending Stanley Cup champions. The Vegas Golden Knights lost last night in Game 7 of their series with the Dallas Stars 2-1. The Stars move on to play the Colorado Avalanche in the next round.
A talented group of musicians is once again headed to New York City for the Essentially Ellington Festival. Don't lie, you're dancing in the background. Now, this is just a taste of the Triangle Youth Jazz Ensemble. They performed yesterday afternoon at Jones Auditorium on the Meredith College campus.
It's a lot of time and effort that we have to put in, but we got to perform for so many people, and the work really does just pay off.
One of the most valuable parts of the music is being able to express yourself on a stage in front of others, and I think we're really grateful for that opportunity here.
Yeah, it's a pretty awesome opportunity, too. Triangle Youth Jazz Ensemble leaves for New York. That is on Wednesday. They are the only band from the Carolinas to perform at the Essentially Ellington Jazz Festival. Good for them.
That's awesome. Well, we are just hours away from fashion's biggest night, the Met Gala. All eyes will be on the museum's iconic staircase, where the stars will align to show their best outfits inspired by this year's theme, Garden of Time. It's inspired by the Costume Institute new exhibition, Sleeping Beauty's Reawakening Fashion. In an interview with Today's Jenna Bush Hager, Vogue's Anna Wintour said that she broke her cardinal rule when picking the theme. Pick something that is clearly defined. Zendaya, Jennifer Lopez, Bad Bunny, and Chris Hemsworth will serve as hosts of the gala.
Madonna breaks concert records, and Adam Driver teams up with Francis Ford Coppola in a new film. Rick DeMiglia has more in the Hollywood Minute.
Madonna takes Rio by storm. The singer concluded her Celebration World Tour with a free concert on Copacabana Beach in Rio de Janeiro. The event attracted an estimated 1.6 million people, marking the largest audience ever for a standalone concert by any artist, according to Live Nation.
Time stop!
Adam Driver reaches new heights. The actor stars in Francis Ford Coppola's Megalopolis, and this is your first look at the epic film. This is the legendary director's first film in over a decade and is set to premiere at the Cannes Film Festival later this month.
I'm accepting this tremendous honor on behalf of every person that has been affected by endometriosis.
Bindi Irwin received the Blossom Award at the Endometriosis Foundation of America's 12th annual Blossom Ball on Friday. The honor recognizes figures who have opened up about their journeys with the condition. The conservationist shared her diagnosis in 2023 and received a standing ovation at the ceremony, where she was joined by her mother and brother. In Hollywood, I'm Rick Damigella.
Fans of a popular sitcom are reminiscing on the show's finale.
So today marks 20 years since the iconic Friends finale aired on TV.
20 years?
20 years, right?
What?
You feel old now?
Yes.
Nearly 53 million people tuned in to see Monica, Ross, Rachel, Phoebe, Chandler, and Joey walk out of the apartment one last time. It was also broadcast in Times Square. And multiple sources confirm the cast will likely celebrate, but of course, Matthew Perry no longer with us here.
Oh my goodness, 20 years. Wow.
Yeah, it's an iconic show.
It really is. It's something that you even today can turn on. Just, I put it on sometimes just to feel good.
Yeah, it's always amazing. Fun to watch.
Yeah.
And hey, before we go to break, here's a look at the winning lottery numbers. We'll have another look on weather and traffic in just a bit. Stay with us.